All right, hello there, welcome back to another Weebin from video. Today's video, getting back into NBA Weekly. Obviously, need to talk about game one of Miami and Denver. I don't want to waste any of your guys' time. I would say let's just get straight into it. Let's explain and let's break down what happened in game one before we get into any more predictions. So game one was a very, very one-sided game throughout most of the game. Obviously, getting to the fourth quarter, things change a little bit. But let's talk about the first three quarters of basketball. Thing number one of what caused the Heat this game. Jimmy Butler obviously needs to be more aggressive. He needs to be more assertive in getting into the paint. Now, there was a lot of times where he did get there and just kind of passed it out because Jokic provided a presence, or maybe Michael Porter Jr., maybe Aaron Gordon. Jimmy has to find a way to get to the free throw line. Having two free throw attempts throughout the entire game is unacceptable. Definitely got to get that figured out. Thing number two, the Heat couldn't hit shit all game. Very evident, of course. They went, I have the stats pulled up next to me. They went 13 for 39, but they shot way worse through the first three quarters. At one point, they were 5 for 24. Max Strus shot 0 for 10. Gabe Vincent was struggling in the first three quarters. Duncan Robinson was struggling. Just a whole lot of, I'm not going to say bricks, but just miss. I mean, Duncan Robinson had some bricks, but shots just were not falling, rimming out or just bouncing from the rim and out. Like, it's just a lot of opportunities to where I can't even give proper credit to Denver on the defensive side of things, because the Heat were just missing shots. What I will say is Denver did a spectacular job on offense. Jokic was a great facilitator today. Jamal Murray played amazing, hit very timely shots, especially when it came to momentum swings, to where Miami was inching a bit closer. Nuggets would always push back and say, hey, y'all is not getting into this game. We're not allowing you to cut it to single digits. Denver did a great job. Reason number three as to why the Heat lost this game. Defensively, they are still figuring out how to guard Denver. Now, if you didn't watch my last NBA Weekly, no worries. Let me fill you in on basically what I was saying on what the game plan was going to be hitting into game one. The game plan, as you saw in the first quarter, was don't let Jokic beat you. Don't let Jamal Murray beat you. Don't give Michael Porter Jr. open threes. The game plan was force Aaron Gordon to do something. And very early on, Aaron Gordon saw that. And what did he do? He did something. He's had, 10 points, 12 points in the first quarter. Phenomenal first quarter for him. So Eric Spoelstra had to come up with an adjustment to say, okay, we can't just allow this to happen all game. So they were introducing all kinds of zone looks, whether it was a 2-3 or a 2-2-1. Or was it a 1-2-2? It was a 2-1-2. And just trying to throw different looks at Denver, which I think was the correct thing to do. Thing is, Denver just was making shots in a timely manner to where the Heat could not really build any momentum. Again, I can't stress enough, Denver's got shooters. That's not even a question. They run an 8-man rotation with the starting five, and then coming off the bench is Christian Braun. I believe it's Bruce Brown and Jeff Green, Uncle Green. All those guys except Christian Braun can really shoot. Bruce Brown can't really shoot, but if he's open, he can knock it down, as you've seen tonight. But anyway, Denver did really good at staying within their lane. Everyone followed suit. Back to the flip side, talking about Miami. Keys to game two, very, very simple. You have to get to the free throw line. You can't just let Denver dictate the flow of the game. Jimmy Butler was creating amazing looks. And to Denver's credit, they didn't really worry about anyone else other than Jimmy. You know, they said, Jimmy's not going to beat us. Everyone else is going to have to beat us. And they didn't. You know, Bam Adebayo had a great game, but clearly that wasn't enough. You need more than just Bam Adebayo doing this. You need, against the Denver team, you need all hands on deck. As you guys have seen in the past, KD and Devin Booker dropping insane numbers. Two people is not enough to beat the Denver Nuggets. If Bam's going off, if Jimmy's going off, it's not going to be enough. But the difference between Devin Booker and going off and Jimmy Butler going off is D-Book's going to do that from three. He'll do it from mid-range. Jimmy's going to tire you out. He's going to get in the paint and he's going to get to the line. He's going to tire you out. He's going to cause fatigue. So whether you're having to give more energy, if you have to give more energy on the defense, it's going to affect you on the offensive end. Jokic is not one of those players who is extremely, what's the word I'm looking for? Conditioned. Definitely has to slow down sometimes. Same with Murray. Murray can get gassed very easily. You know, which is funny because these guys are both logging in 40 plus minutes. So you're thinking, are you sure? Yeah, there's plays where they kind of take breaks. Jokic as well, when he facilitates. Watch him very closely. He doesn't move a whole lot on offense. He's just eyeballing. When he does get down in the paint, same thing though, but he's probably going to swing it out. He doesn't really exert too much energy to where he can't be efficient on the defensive end, because they need him to be efficient enough, especially with this Miami team that's really going to want to get in the paint if they're not shooting threes. And if they're shooting threes, you still have someone like Jimmy to get in the paint. So it's very exhausting to guard Miami. But again, can't stress enough, if Miami is not going to hit open threes especially, it's going to cause a massive problem. Keys to game two, Miami's got to get to the paint. Denver, huge key for them is to stay disciplined. Don't do too much. What they did really, really well, which I just mentioned earlier, they stayed in their lane. They filled their role perfectly to a T. Game plan was phenomenal. Loved what they were doing. They were saying, we're going to play basketball the way that you're going to allow us to play. If you want to give Aaron Gordon looks, we're going to go to Aaron Gordon. If you want to give Murray looks, we're going to Murray. They're not force feeding anyone. They're letting opportunities come to them, which is really beautiful basketball, by the way. I really love it. I was mentioning to my brother during the game, I was like, if you watch closely, Miami's having to work really hard for their buckets. Really, really, really hard. Denver, on the opposite side of the spectrum, it looked effortless. It looked really, really effortless. Now, I know what a lot of Heat fans are thinking. Shoot, even Nuggets fans are thinking. This is looking like a Nuggets sweep or gentleman sweep. And this is where I disagree. One thing that you have to appreciate throughout this entire game is the adjustments by Eric Spoelstra, right? When Aaron Gordon was going off, what did he do? He switched it up, causing him to not... He had 4 points the rest of the game after the first quarter. Right, that's not a coincidence. It's called adjustments. Eric Spoelstra is really, really good at making adjustments. Also, in the fourth quarter, when the Nuggets offense was stalling, it wasn't by coincidence, it was by design. Now, is it going to work every single time? No. But Eric Spoelstra is someone who is going to adjust his rotation accordingly. Let me remind you, Kevin Love was the starter. Then he put in Caleb Martin, right? Something that is extremely to take note of, extremely important to take note of, is that Eric Spoelstra is willing to change the starting lineup. He's willing to adjust his rotations for whatever he needs to happen. And that's something that I'm expecting soon. Granted, Tyler Hero is on the way back anyway, so rotations were going to change. Tyler Hero's either going to make it on the way back game two or game three. That's a huge addition to the Heat, because today, what happened to them was their offense was stalling out. You had someone like Tyler Hero, who is an elite shooter, right? In all facets of the game. Shoot threes, mid-ranges, fadeaways, whatever. He's just good at making difficult shots. Two, it's someone that the Nuggets have to worry about. You can't just leave Tyler Hero alone. So it takes a breather off of Jimmy. It takes a breather off of Bam, Gabe Vincent, Max Schertz if he's in at the time, or Duncan Robinson probably shifts more to just a flat out bench role. Caleb Martin, if you can get open looks, he'll hit him, right? They just realistically got to be open. But just a bad game from the Heat that I truly believe they can bounce back from. That also is something that you need to look forward to, is you lost by 11, but your team fought to the end, and Jimmy only scored 13 points. How many free throws did Jimmy have? Was he the one with free throws, or was it someone else? Jimmy had 0 free throws. You're also playing game one, where Denver has had all week to rest, and you guys haven't had much. It's a lot about testing the waters. Also, they need to get familiarized with the Mile High climate. So I'm not trying to say the Heat are going to win or anything. Granted, I still think they will. Personally, I would say in 7 now, though, after seeing game one. But with that being said, I don't want people to think this isn't going to be a fun series, because it's one game, whole lot of variables that you need to talk about. And again, Jimmy Butler is an elite player who shows up when he has to. Game two will be much more competitive. If the Nuggets win game two, I would say without question, you're probably looking at two must-win games. Like the Heat can't go down 3-1. They just can't. The Heat go down 3-1, it's over. Nuggets aren't losing 3 in a row. at some point the Heat have to win either game two or win both game three and four. Because if the Heat go down 3-1, Denver's too good of a team to lose three in a row, which is definitely crazy to think about, because you got a team full of shooters. You got a team with Nikola Jokic, Jamal Murray. And the fact that I'm going to sit here and tell y'all that I still think the Heat are going to win, especially after the game one performance, it's pretty wild. But I've been watching this Heat team and Nugget team all season, by the way. The Heat don't stop fighting. It is insane. The more that I think about, I think the 3-1's even possible for the Heat. Unlikely, of course. I'm not even getting into that. But this team has been in so many clutch games. And even when they seem like they're out of it, they're never out of it. And I'm very much looking forward to game two. Nuggets fans, y'all should definitely be happy. Very much looking forward to what's to come. Heat fans, it's not the end of the world. It's one game. It's a best of seven for a reason. LeBron has lost how many game ones and, you know, won the championship? Ridiculous amount of times. I mean, granted, LeBron has four championships. That's not the point I'm trying to fucking make. The point I'm trying to make is game ones are not what dictate the series. It's what you do after, right? Game two, game three. Game three is probably one of the most important games in terms of playoff series, but a whole lot of adjustments are going to be made after tonight. Teams are going to start to get familiarized with one another. They're going to start to learn how to guard one another properly. Because obviously film is one thing, but it's a whole other thing when you're actually doing it, right? Difference between theory and then actual practice. Film is great. Nuggets obviously had a lot more time to do that. Also rest. But again, can't stress enough. Game two happens, game three happens. By game four, you're already fucking hating who you're against. Like, you already have a serious hatred for that. There's probably gonna be some scuffles throughout game four and five, let's be honest, because it's just gonna get more heated as the series goes along. But can't stress enough as well, Nuggets ain't losing three in a row. He either has to take game two or must wins game three and four. Y'all, I just don't see Denver losing three in a row. But I think this is a great series. I think this is great for basketball. On a side note, let's talk a little bit about my Lakers. Now, Austin Reeves supposedly could get up to $100 million from the Lakers, depending on who offers him what. Spurs are supposedly also in the running. Should the Lakers pay Austin Reeves $100 million? Yes. Assuming it's over 4 years, that's $25 million a year. Yeah, you can't lose Austin Reeves. You can't do that. LeBron is what's looking like his last year. You can't not pay the man. A must. It's you have to. Him and Rui have to be must. What they do with D'Lo, curious. Probably looking to move him. I just don't see how you can look at D'Lo the same way. When in a must-win series, he doesn't show up, and defensively, he was non-existent. He got picked on. It was just not pleasant, rough to say the least. Again, I'm a Laker fan, and I'm saying this, definitely not happy about it. Going into the other stuff, James Harden to the Rockets. A lot of reports talking about that for James Harden and free agency. I don't know. I just don't see why. Like, is Houston really going to compete right now? I don't think so. I mean, maybe they can, you know, sign James Harden. People are talking about, oh, Jaylen Brown needs to get traded. Like, if that were the case, you know, Houston definitely would be someone interested in Jaylen Brown if they did get Harden. But there's a whole lot of ifs and what into the offseason. I'm definitely going to have offseason coverage for NBA weekly, or maybe at that point it'll be bi-weekly. Because what would there be to talk about every week once we're in the offseason? Free agency for sure. The draft is shortly after the NBA finals. So yeah, we got a lot to look forward to, but can't stress enough, NBA finals is not over yet. Y'all got a lot of game left. Heat fans, don't panic. I know y'all have to panic because you're a fan, but don't panic. Nuggets fans though, they're hungry. They're ready. They're ready to see this team win the chip. Personally, I still think there's a lot of competitive and great basketball left to be played. We'll see how game two goes. Expect a lot of adjustments from Eric Spoelstra. Expect different defensive looks again. Expect Jimmy Butler to be assertive as hell, because if not, this game will not be competitive. They know what they got to do to make this game competitive. I don't think Bam will have another 20-point game. I just don't see it, because he's not really been that consistent. But I also don't expect freaking Max Strus to go 0-10. But anyway, fun edition of NBA Weekly, talking about the finals. We've come a long way, and I look forward to seeing game 2 and 3, and then I'll see you guys on the next NBA Weekly. As always, this is Ollie Been Different. We've Been Different, and we out.